Hey folks, how you doing? It's Mark again. This is How We Did It, Volume 12 is upon us. So in this one, we're going to be talking about Thomas Dolby, who is somebody who I think is one of the most important figures in the history of British music, electronically certainly, and you know, he's has links to hip hop and everything. Very big character in the crossover from the late 70s to the 80s, and the use of early synths and the very first samplers, okay? So I'm just gonna use, you gotta try and imagine, some of you won't be old enough, but imagine it's 1979. Basically, synths have been around, but they don't sound very good. And when they do invent them and bring them out, they are so hard to work that you have to hire someone like Thomas Dolby in, because he knows how to actually make them work. So this is talking about a synth called a PPG Wave, which was a German synthesizer at the time. And there's a track by Foreigner called I've Been Waiting for a Girl Like You, okay? Big sort of soft rock tune. And before we go off on our journey, I just want to sort of bring this in, because Thomas Dolby, they actually hired him in to do the intro to this record, okay? So check this out. You know, you don't know how to use synths, you get a man to do this for you. Okay, soft rock cheese in full effect. But, you know, that's Thomas Dolby there using, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, a PPG Wave, which is a German synthesizer. These things weren't very good at the start. They were about the size of a semi-detached house. They could only sort of do a certain amount of sounds that are very reedy and thin. But around this time, so like late 70s, early 80s, you've got a change coming, okay? A company called Fairlight, CMI from Australia, invented the first sampler. But before we go down that, I just want to play you a couple of tunes from Thomas Dolby's first album, which is called The Golden Age of Wireless. And he took the money that he made from playing on that Foreigner track and invested it in this album called The Golden Age of Wireless, which, if you get a chance, listen to that and then remind yourself that it's made in 1982, because there's aspects of it that are irreplaceably brilliant as regards electronic sound. I'm going to give you the breakdown of One of Our Submarines off vinyl here. German pressing. Piece of brilliance there, okay? The whole album is brilliant. We're going to get into some other stuff, okay? So what I like about that track is also that it's about Thomas's uncle who died in World War II in a submarine, so that's using history. Just like the Spiky T track was about his family's history, that's Thomas doing the same thing. Okay, so for fans of Prefab Sprout, you will know an album that looks like this and is called Steve McQueen. So basically, Thomas Dolby produced this and he also plays on it. And I wanted to have a look at ways of looking at genetic evidence of Thomas's involvement by playing some of his solo tracks and also playing some of these Prefab Sprout tracks. Okay, so this is Bonnie, which is certainly probably a lot of people's favourite British singer-songwriter tune. Absolutely stunning. And I've got the middle eight here where he's using possibly a PPG Wave, or certainly one of those early synths. Words don't hold you, broken soldiers. So listen to that synth top line. Whoa, how beautiful is that? Just exquisite. Prefab Sprout, absolutely amazing. Lyrics, music, everything. Of course, Thomas produced that album. And there's a track called Mulu the Rainforest, which is off Thomas Dolby's second album. And I want you to just listen to him using the same sound again so you can see the genetic link. Okay, let's flip it up. Okay, same album, Prefab Sprout. Desire as a self-figured creature who changes her mind. The boy's good at lyrics is the old Paddy. Listen to the chord pads. Okay, beautiful sound. Let's go, that's Prefab Sprout. Let's go to Thomas, Budapest by Blimp off his third album. Just, you know, nice to see how someone's skill at programming synthesizers and the abilities they've had can make, you know, classic singer-songwriter stuff and then, you know, also be on the edge of basically technology taking over the world. And this is what I find astonishing and brilliant about all of this. So Whodini, right? They did a track called Mr. Magic's Wand, and guess who produced it and did the music? It's Thomas Dolby. Okay, so let me dig that out. And really, the amazing thing about this is that in 1979, Mr. Magic did the world's first hip-hop radio show. So that's how far we're going back and connecting this era, okay? Mr. Magic's Wand, okay? Contains over 21 seconds of music. So I'm going to sample this and then put Missy Elliot over the top of it on this track that we're dealing with. But I want to use this opportunity to talk about Jive, okay? So Jive, Mutt Lange, who has got a ridiculous name for one, married Shania Twain and divorced her subsequently. But he started Jive in London as a South African. And at the beginning, before he went down the road of Britney Spears and Tribe Called Quest and all of that stuff, there's this little album that came out, and this is also 1982, so that's the same year as Thomas Dolby's The Golden Age of Wireless, and it's also the same year as that Whodini's Mr. Magic's one. Now, this, I think, is one of those tunes where, at the time, you'd hear DMC finals, people scratching in clubs or tapes on the radio from New York or whatever, and you'd hear this track, and you go, well, what on earth is that track? Because it kind of sounds a bit like it could be Planet Rock. It sounds a bit like it could be Kraftwerk. It sounds a bit whatever. Well, it's actually the Willesden Dodgers, okay? And Dr. Dre used to DJ this a lot, and it's in that documentary about him. So, yeah, this was made by some chaps just up the street here in NW10. This is just the sickest beat. Ride on it, because no one's going to come after this copyright. It's too deep underground. I think popping started in LA, yeah? So you can see how they popped to this one. It's so clear you could mix anything on this. It's Time, Al Nafish, The Soul. Anything you want. It's got a nice breakdown coming over here. See, what gets me about that music is it sounds more futuristic than anything we've made since, which is funny. But this is the beginnings of why you're able to listen to all the music ever made in the world on your phone, okay, is electronic digital musical compression and also just being able to sample. So the very first sampler was a Fairlight CMI, okay, and it was used. The first person to use it on a record was Peter Gabriel, okay. Fairlight were an Australian company named after a ferry outside of his granny's house, I believe. And they were trying to get on this synthesizer game with PPG Wave as well. You know, trying to compete with them. And they made this machine that did some synthesis. But basically, when he was trying to test it, he sampled a piano off the radio. I use the word sampler because this is the first time it was ever done. And then he pitched it up and down the keyboard. And he thought, well, why do we need to make synthesis when you can actually steal a piano off the radio, and then it actually sounds better than any of the synthesizer noises I'm making, which really, that is a massively key moment in music history, isn't it? Because basically that's the first time anyone stole something and then made something new with it, okay? So they then went around and sold these Fairlight synthesizer stroke samplers for 25,000 quid a pop, once again, probably about the size of a semi-detached house. And Peter Gabriel was so into them, he came up with the idea of helping them market them and selling them. And I think he sold them to Led Zeppelin's bassist, he sold them to lots of people, because it was suddenly like, oh my God, we don't need you know, to have a horn section, we can just sample a little bit of horn. But of course, it sounded quite awful at the beginning. And then they got pushed out of the market by EMU samplers, Synclavier, all these people. But at the very beginning, I believe the first track to use a Fairlight sampler was Shock the Monkey by Peter Gabriel. And you know, I was really into this Peter Gabriel's music when I was a kid, particularly this era stuff, because this stuff's amazing, okay? Politically, I mean, on this album alone, right, there's one about him shooting the President of America. There's one about Steve Biko's beaten to death in his cell in South Africa. There's Games Without Frontiers, which is just amazing lyrically. And actually, I think there's a sampler at the end of, he's using, at the end of Games of Frontiers, he's using the Fairlight. But let's listen to the beginning of Shock the Monkey first. Amazing. And there's probably a Fairlight in there doing one of the noises, okay? I can't tell you because I wasn't there, but I've seen photographs of Gabriel sat down with, like, you know, all these screens in green around him. So he was a very forward-thinking man for sure. And Games Without Frontiers, at the end of it, it turns into, like, almost like a... sounds like Pharrell Williams. The rhythm track, yeah? So basically, at the time, both Gabriel and Thomas Dolby had this interest in African music, which was obviously taking off with Paul Simon in the charts and everything, but they were doing it first. Let's get that straight. And it's a weird collision, because it's almost like they're trying to, you know, they're giving humanity access to all this digital technology, but at the same time, they're trying to involve the humanity of live music and keep them together. And I think Europa and the Pirate Twins by Thomas Dolby does that, because this is off his Golden Age of Wireless album. But check out, I mean, no one can beat this for electronic pop vibe, but he's got like harmonicas and stuff in it. It's almost like saying, hang on, human race, don't go all the way down the hill and end up on an iPhone all your life. Let's put in a little bit of live music. Here we go. Amazing, amazing stuff. And remember, these guys would be fighting for days on end to get the equipment to work to get that sort of response. Anyway, so let's flip it now, okay? That's what was going on in rock, pop, electronica, okay? What was going on in New York, okay? 1979, people have gone uptown with hip-hop. You've got Debbie Harry, CBGBs, all of that action going on. Mr. Magic starts a radio show with Marley Marl. I've got some cassettes of it here. I was lucky enough to buy when they were reissuing those at the time. And Whodini, who were a kind of... they were sort of a little bit ahead of their time, in the sense that they didn't have a chance to make much music with samples in it because the equipment wasn't there. So all of their productions were kind of like... in fact, you know, One Love by Nas, that's taken from this Whodini track. Okay, so that's One Love, One Love, etc., etc. And So the track I've taken is Mr. Magic's Wand, okay? So Mr. Magic went on to have a beef with Red Alert, which formed the bridge is over, all of that stuff, okay? This is, you know, from the 1980 onwards, what really was hip-hop to the world, okay? So Mr. Magic's Wand, I've sampled that, and I've put Missy Elliott over, and also, as a little addition, I've put this guy on there. If anyone can guess who this is, you get a prize by before the end, I don't know, maybe not. Here we go.
This is a Mr. Magic, super, super flash. Let the beat commence. See, we feel that it's time for you to pump it out loud. And when I got the rhyme, so everybody get hyped. It's the way it should be. Sicilian compliments of the 783. Just pause.
That's Thomas Dolby there, yeah? That's just Dolby on his own. Okay, so that's Dolby with some extra production in there. And that's the drums from Bounce Rock Skate Roll I've got underneath, okay, which is a classic breakbeat bass line in there. Okay, so there you go. Missy Elliott riding on top of Mr. Magic's Rap Attack by Whodini. Thomas Dolby on the production, me on the reproduction. I stuck them together. But, you know, what I wanted to try and get across most there, which I didn't really do that good a job of, but is the history of the Fairlight, for instance, you know, and the PPG Wave, which these things were just huge bits of equipment, which now we've got, you know, a million times more power in our phones. But that was the beginning of all that electronic era. You know, add that to the drum machines and you've got, you know, some of our famous and some of the best music made, certainly in dance music. This guy here, sorry, I told you, that's Muggs, who did House of Pain Jump Around. And the first rap on that is by one of these guys from 783, who are a West Coast band. But look at how fresh-faced Muggs looks there. He looks like he's 18 years old or something. Some other tunes that are of that era, and weirdly, I got this track the other day, a lot of you will know, but this is Italian stuff from the era, and it's the instrumental of Kano, okay? I don't know if you know this, Another Life. This is same sort of gear, okay? So, early synth. Amazing. Italo disco. I'm not going to go on too much. Thanks for watching. That was This Is How We Did It, Volume 12. Looking at some of the history of Thomas Dolby, Peter Gabriel, sampling, Mr. Magic, who did the show with Marley Marl. And thank you all for watching. I'll be back next week with another one. I'm out. It's Mark. Peace.